It's a beautiful day in Coney Island. You can see the cyclone behind me, and I want to share a bit of New York City history that's hidden in plain sight, easily overlooked. It's right here at the entrance to the New York City Aquarium, and it's this, the Bathysphere. It's the world's first deep sea submersible. In the 1930s, it made record-setting dives down to depths of over 3,000 feet. It was the world's first deep sea exploration. It's the grandfather of all the deep sea subs to come, including, yes, the Titanic sub that exploded. And it's right here. We're going to talk more about it on today's episode of Submerged Stories.
You've obviously heard of the ill-fated Titan submersible that imploded above the Titanic. There was also the Deep Sea Challenger, which James Cameron piloted to the deepest point on this planet. Before that, there's the Alvin, which discovered the Titanic and has been a decades-long workhorse of deep sea science. There was the Trieste, the first vessel to reach the bottom of the Marianas Trench. But it all started here with this groundbreaking submersible, the Bathysphere. The Bathysphere is one of the earliest deep sea science expeditions, and it marks the beginning of human exploration of the deep sea, what is still to this day the least explored ecosystem on our planet Earth. The Bathysphere was the brainchild of engineer Otis Barton. But Barton couldn't do this alone. He needed to team up with William Beebe. Beebe was the leading natural scientist of his time. Beebe was a published author and respected public speaker. Think David Attenborough level of famous. Beebe was a leader at the New York Zoological Society, which is the predecessor organization that predates the modern-day Bronx Zoo and New York Aquarium. Otis Barton was independently wealthy, and he didn't let a little thing like, you know, the Great Depression, stop him from developing and fabricating his innovative spherical diving design. But Beebe was the one who gave the project scientific heft.
Now, it took a lot of courage to go down in the Bathysphere. I'll tell the internet, the public, I'm 5'7". This thing is not really even that much taller than me. It's about 5 feet in diameter, and it fit two people. They both fit in here. They had to be crunched down the entire time and to be sealed in. There was no exit from the inside. You had to get inside, get sealed in, have these bolted down, two people in here for hours at a time in the pitch black darkness of the deep sea.
There were many risks involved with deep sea diving. An unmanned test found leaks in the quartz glass. If Barton or Beebe had been on board for these early tests, then water jets at over 1,300 pounds per square inch would have cut them into pieces.
But what might be the scariest thing of all is this right here, which is the cable that connected the Bathysphere to the surface. You can see there's no propulsion on this thing. It was literally just a steel orb that was dropped from a steel cable off of a boat and hovered, dragged along beneath the surface. So this was all that kept them from falling to the depths of the ocean, never to be seen again. This was the only thing that kept the two divers inside alive. This bolt were to fail, this part were to break, or the steel cable were to snap, they would never be seen again.
The Bathysphere team was more than just Barton and Beebe. There was a whole topside crew of dedicated scientists, engineers, and sailors. And despite the many challenges posed by deep sea diving, this team came together to overcome each and every one of them and make this expedition into a groundbreaking success. By the early 20th century, scientists already knew that there was life in the deep sea. Dredging nets had pulled up strange creatures from miles below the surface. But what they didn't know was what those creatures really looked like when they were alive. Most of what came up in nets was damaged, you know, warped by the sudden pressure changes of being yanked up from such deep depths. Delicate textures had ruptured, colors had faded, bioluminescence had vanished. But from inside the Bathysphere, Beebe became the first scientist to observe deep sea life where it lived.
So picture, this is your only porthole. We're 3,000 feet deep. It is pitch black. Hundreds of tons of pressure all around you. You were secured only by these bolts and the steel cable running into the boat above you. Though there's a little bit of light inside this cabin. There's two of you crammed in here, and you are making discoveries that the scientific world has never before seen. These are deep sea creatures that have never been seen before, some of which won't be documented again for another 100 years until later expeditions, some of which have never been seen again.
Deep beneath the waves, Barton and Beebe became the first humans ever to lay eyes on a whole set of new alien species. Some of these creatures look like they belong on Mars, but they're not from out of this world. They're from right here on planet Earth. Beebe's most prized discovery was a fish that he named the Bathysphera Intacta, the untouchable bathysphere fish. It was a 6-foot-long giant dragonfish, which Beebe claimed circled his vessel multiple times. This fish was never seen again. And later, other scientists would discredit the discovery. It's the same thing that happened with the 5-lined constellation fish, or the pallid sailfish, or the 3-starred anglerfish. All of these fish were documented by Beebe, but have never been seen again. And some believe Beebe made it up for the media attention. And you know what? Maybe he did. Beebe had bills to pay. He had to come back with a good story to justify this huge expeditionary bill that he had rung up. And he'd rung up in the middle of the Great Depression, no less. If he was spending all this money in such a desperate time, he had to come back with a good story. But then again, I don't know. Maybe he didn't make it up. We know that there are missing giants in the deep ocean. It's a big, big ocean, and new discoveries are being made every year. Maybe, just maybe, future scientists will vindicate Beebe and his 6-foot-long, untouchable fish. In the end, what Beebe truly brought back from the deep was a vision, a new way of thinking about the ocean. Not as a hostile void, but as a living world full of mystery. You know, I didn't mention this, but I should have said at the height of his fame, Beebe did a live radio broadcast from inside the bathysphere, 1/2 mile deep. This was when radio was still a new technology. NBC had only been founded just a few years earlier. For many people living in the 1930s, this would have been the first nature program they had ever heard, let alone heard live from 3,000 feet deep in the Atlantic Ocean. Now, with no way to record radio back then, that broadcast is now lost forever, but transcripts survive. And from the deep depths of the ocean inside the bathysphere, Beebe told millions of Americans that the deep sea was not a dark pit devoid of life. Instead, he told them it was a place full of life and worth exploring and understanding. In his words, what he saw was, quote, a sea boiling with lights. So think about it. This is the great granddaddy of all deep sea exploration. I mean, maybe there'd been some nets and draggers before, but this is the grandfather of all manned deep sea submersible science. Anything that we know about the deep sea, the Marianas Trench, the Alvin submersible, the Titan sub and the Titanic that exploded trying to explore that shipwreck, all of it, manned deep sea exploration, ultimately can draw a line directly back to this bathysphere, the world's first submersible. And it's pretty crazy. I mean, I'm touching it. This is not a replica. It's not a reproduction. It's not a model. This is the real vessel. It's almost 100 years old, and it's here. Coney Island, shadow of the cyclone, in front of the New York City Aquarium, available and on display to the public. It's a pretty incredible and amazing piece of history with a huge backstory behind it, available for us to explore. So I hope you've learned something. Hope you have gotten excited about the deep sea world, and we will see you next time on another episode of Submerged Stories.
So I hope you enjoyed that video, learned something about the deep sea or hidden history in New York City, early submersibles. I figure if you are interested in scuba diving in the marine world, you're the kind of person who would subscribe to this channel. You would find that that kind of story is interesting to you. I do want to take a second, rather than have a clean, quick outro for YouTube, just to thank some people and cite some sources. Of course, first and foremost, has to be the Wildlife Conservation Society. That is the successor organization that runs the New York Aquarium today. They are where they are preserving this history. That's where you can see the bathysphere. You should go. You should get a ticket. You should see the aquarium. You should learn about this stuff in person. They also captured many of the sketches, captured, digitized, and restored many of the sketches, which were created by the team down there. And these are really genuine works of art. It's pretty incredible. I actually think I'm going to make another video about it. There were some of the actually interesting forgotten women on his team who did these sketches and captured these images, which I just totally fell in love with. And I also want to thank this book. I highly recommend it. It's called The Descent by Brad Mattson. It's an excellent history of the Barton Beebe bathysphere dives. I relied on it as my primary source. Is this something you'd heard about before? Did you know that the bathysphere was there? Are you interested in going to see it now that you know it exists? I think it deserves a lot more credit and attention than it currently gets. I hope you enjoyed this video, you found it interesting. If you find any of this stuff interesting, right,
history, science, marine creatures, scuba diving. This is the channel for you. I'll see you guys next time in another episode of Submerged Stories.